Uncertainty, overwhelm, confusion, chaos, anger, frustration, disappointment, helplessness. Those are just a few of the emotions that have engulfed us, overwhelmed us, consumed us on a daily basis this year, consistently. We've lost jobs. We've lost loved ones. Many of us are working from home while being the substitute teacher for our kids. This is not how 2020 was supposed to be. This was not it. This is not how it was supposed to be. On March 10th, I flew back from a business trip, and I was excited. I was so excited about this first quarter. I was so excited about 2020. And a couple of days after I landed from that business trip is when the NBA had two players test positive for COVID-19, and they stopped their season. And right after that, everything stopped. And on that day, my business lost six figures in revenue. About 3 weeks later, one of the closest people to me passed away. And I wasn't able to be with her during that transition. And as things started to open up, my husband and I were still very concerned. So we had to make the really tough decision to pull our youngest daughter from her lacrosse and her volleyball teams, sports that she absolutely loves. And most recently, our oldest daughter went to college. But we didn't get to do that traditional freshman experience of taking our daughter and getting her settled in because of the obvious and understandable protocols, the quarantine protocols of New York City. And then Ahmaud Arbery, George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, and so many other people that we will never know their names were unjustly murdered. And our country had to take another serious look in the mirror and decide where does she stand on social injustice? And this was a relief for many. It was a burden for others. And unfortunately, it was a continued denial for far too many. And with all of this pain and discourse, many of us felt like, oh my God, can I take any more punches? Can I take any more punches? For me, at one point, I was getting punch after gut punch after gut punch after gut punch to where I screamed from the bottom of my soul, I am done. I am done. I quit. I quit. And my dear friend of about 25 years was on the phone with me. She was like, whoa, sis. Whoa, wow. I've known you for a really long time. I have never, ever, ever heard those words come out of your mouth. And she said, the sad thing is I believe you. I believe you. And the truth is, I was done. I had done all I knew to do, and I was done. And as I laid on that bathroom floor and I cried 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 some more and I cried. I cried because I really wanted to quit. And I cried even harder because I knew I couldn't quit. I want to let that sink in. I cried even harder because I knew I could not quit. With all the pain and suffering that we've had in 2020, I know many of us have felt like, you know what? We can just cancel this year, right? Especially in this age of cancel culture. In this age of, let's just cancel it. Let's just be done. Let's just, like me, let's just quit. Let's just stop. And I know Kim started with this, but it's so important that I want to read it. I want to read it for us because I think it's so important for us to really understand. What if 2020 isn't canceled? What if 2020 is the year we've been waiting for? A year so uncomfortable, so painful, so scary, so raw, that it finally forces us to grow. A year that screams so loud, finally, awakening us from our ignorant slumber. A year that we finally accept the need for change, declare change, work for change, become the change. A year we finally band together instead of pushing each other further apart. 2020 isn't canceled, but rather, it's the most important year of them all. Because see, as I laid on that bathroom floor, defeated, deflated, and empty, it reminded me of another time that I was exhausted and absolutely burned out. And it reminded me of when I was exhausted and when I was burned out, I just kept saying, I'm empty. I'm empty. I don't have anything else to give. I'm empty. And as I was in that very tough and challenging place, I started to realize that, you know what, Sheri? You have got to shift your mind. You've got to shift this thinking. You got to shift this. And as I laid there and I thought about just how empty I was, I started to really think about, you know what, Sheri? Are you empty? Because that just sounds so discouraging. Or have you given your all? And when I really thought about it, that was more of my truth. I had given my all. And every time I said it, I felt just a little more encouraged. I had given my all. Every time I said it, I got a little more energized. I have given my all. Every time I said it, I felt like I had accomplished something. I felt victorious. I had given my all. And when I focused on not I'm empty and I'm exhausted and I'm burnt out, when I focused on I have given my all, that's when I realized it wasn't time to quit. It was time to recharge. It was time to recharge. How to power forward in times of uncertainty in order for us to recharge, refocus, in order for us to rejuvenate, in order for us to get back up off that floor, we have to ask one very important question. One very important question. What does this make possible? What does this make possible? I need you to write that down. I need you to write that down. I need you to write that in the chat box. What does this make possible? Write it in the chat box. Put it in your notes. What does this make possible? Because when we think about that question, when we answer that question, it allows us to, you know, okay, let me, when I was writing my book, Exponential Living, Stop Spending 100% of Your Time on 10% of Who You Are, my dear friend Usher, he wrote the foreword for my book. And I went over to his house, and we were sitting in the kitchen. And I went over there because I wanted to just spend some time, right? I wanted to just really share with him the vision and the purpose of this book that had been taking me 7 years to write. So, I'd been pouring my heart and soul into this book. And so I went to his house and we're sitting in the kitchen and I'm sharing with him about the power of peace. About the power of peace, and peace is the core of what we need, and peace is the power, peace is the new success. And I could tell he was, you know, he was kind of looking at me a little funny, you know, but I'm thinking he's just really, really listening, right? And so I keep going, and he finally goes, Sheri, hold on, stop. I don't want to be disrespectful, but you sound delusional. I'm glad he didn't want to be disrespectful. And so I'm kind of stunned. Like, what do you mean? And he's like, okay. He was like, let me get this straight. Because you want me to write the foreword to this. So I need to understand this. He was like, so what you're saying is that when people are faced with challenges and struggles and pain and frustration, they're just supposed to go, it's okay. I've got peace. Everything's cool. I have peace. I was like, no, it's the exact opposite. What I'm saying is that in the midst of the challenges, in the midst of the frustration, in the midst of the pain, that's when it's most important for us to lock into our inner peace. We just saw how we center ourselves and why it's so important to center ourselves, because that's where our power is. And so I was like, Usher, it's the exact opposite. What I'm saying is that peace empowers us to see the possibilities. You want to answer the question, what does this make possible? Then you got to lock into your peace, because that's what lets you see the possibilities of what's possible. So we're sitting there and I see he's kind of grasping it. So I said, okay, we're sitting again in his kitchen, right? And so I see some bananas. I see a fruit basket, actually, a fruit basket on his counter. And I said, so let me see. I said, you see these bananas? And he was like, yeah, I see the bananas. I said, well, these bananas are starting to get some brown spots on them, right? He's like, yeah, that's true. I said, so delusional would be if I was looking at these bananas that are obviously browning, they have brown spots on them. If I said to you, Usher, you see these bananas? They are so fresh. These bananas are great. Like, these bananas are ripe, they're fresh. I said, that would be delusional. But when I say to you, you see these browning bananas? Let's peel them, put them in our freezer, and we can eat them later when we put them in our smoothies. See, that's seeing the possibilities. That's seeing the possibilities. When we focus on our peace and get solid in our peace, we can see the possibilities. When we get focused in on peace, that's when we get our vision. That's when we get our vision. And when you get clear on your vision is when you can make a decision. See, the challenge is when we get in struggles and challenges like 2020, so many of us want to just say, I don't know. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to say. I don't know where to help. I don't know where to support. But when we get solid in our peace, it gives us the vision so that we can then decide. My favorite book, My favorite book says, write the vision and make it plain. Peace gives us vision. Vision empowers us to decide. And then when we decide, we get clarity. We get clarity. Clarity gives you the confidence to commit. Clarity gives you the confidence to commit. What I've discovered is that so many of us are just trying to repair the shattered places in our lives. When this current trauma that we're in, I don't think it was meant for us to fix the broken self that we brought into 2020. What I believe is that this current trauma was meant to shake us up just so we could own our greatness instead of trying to prove our greatness. Ah, y'all didn't get that. If y'all got that, I would have heard something in this spread out audience here. Did y'all hear that? Let me say it again, because I need you guys to get this. What I need you to understand, it's not about you fixing the broken self that came into 2020. This year is about you owning your greatness and stop trying to prove your greatness. I need you guys to write that down. I need you guys to share that in the chat box. I need you to make that declaration. I will own my greatness. Matter of fact, I want you to do more than writing it down. I need you to yell it in your computer screen. I will own my greatness. One more time. I will own my greatness. Yes. Because when you have clarity, you get the confidence to commit to your own greatness. And when you bring peace and clarity together, oh my God, you get the courage to take action. And that's where our results are. That's where the results are. When we hit a place in our lives, like 2020 has presented, we have to stay committed to our goal and flexible with our plan. We have to stay committed to our goal and flexible with our plan. My dear cousin, she trained for over a year for the Honolulu Marathon, 26.2 miles marathon. She trained for over a year. So about a week before she left for Hawaii, she said, hey, Sheri, you just recently resigned from your job. You want to go to Hawaii? And I was like, absolutely. Absolutely. So for me, I'm like, okay, great trip to Hawaii. Let's go. So we get to Hawaii. And she trained for a year for this marathon. The morning of the marathon, I decide, oh, I'm going to walk it with you. Who does that? I mean, for real, who does that? Look, either my grandmother or the Bible says, God protects children and fools. And I was grown. So you guys know I fell on the spectrum, right? So I get up and I decide, okay, I'm gonna walk this marathon with you. I'm gonna join you. And so with the marathon, for those of you who have done a marathon, you know this, but every, like, you have these stations for the entire 26 miles. So you have water stations and protein bar stations and bathrooms and Gatorade stations. You have bands playing and people cheering you on. So you have all these places to stop. And her training was she'd run and walk. So we had the goal. The goal was to finish the marathon. At about mile 20, our legs were brutal. They were in so much pain. Hip flexors were locked up, back was sore, blisters were forming on our feet. So at mile 20, we made the decision. We can no longer stop. No more water, no more bathroom breaks, no more stops. We also decided that at this point, we were going to have to adjust the plan. No more running. We knew that we had to slow down so that we would have the energy to finish. So we were still committed to the goal, but we had to adjust our plan. See, when you have the peace, the clarity, and the courage, it empowers you to make adjustments to the plan while still staying committed to the goal. See, at the beginning of this year, I'm gonna just be transparent. For me, I was excited about 2020. This was my year. This was my year. Come on, 2020. Vision, clear vision. And a dear friend of mine, and you all know, Jennifer Holmes, she invited me to join her for Oprah's, Oprah's Vision Tour, Oprah's 2020 Vision Tour. And so she asked me to join her, and I did. And so we're at the State Farm Arena in Atlanta, Georgia, 20,000 people. It was magnetic. The energy, the excitement. This is January 2020. There was so much energy, so much excitement. It was just like, honestly, in all transparency, as bad as this year has been, and this year has been awful, honestly, there's been some great things that have come out of this year. I mean, I absolutely hate how we got to the shelter in place, but that downtime, oh my God, my family, the bonding that we had during that time. I've talked to others that have said that slowdown helped them in so many ways. Businesses have had to pivot and realize different things that they've been able to accomplish. So there were some great things that have come out of 2020. And so I am at this Oprah Vision 2020 tour, and Oprah all day long, she kept saying, how? She'd talk about something, she'd talk about the how. Speakers would come out, she'd talk about the how. And I got this revelation when she kept talking about the how, H-O-W. I got this revelation that spoke to me that I needed to rearrange those words. I needed to rearrange those words. So the letters, H-O-W, I needed to rearrange those letters. And so I was reminded of that when I was laid out on that bathroom floor, crying my heart out. I thought about what came to me in that vision tour with Oprah, and that I needed to rearrange those words, those letters, H-O-W. And I had to rearrange those letters on that bathroom floor to say, Sheri, who, and the who is you. You are the who that you're looking for, Sheri. You are the hero that you need to get yourself up off of this floor. IWL, you are the hero that we need right now. IWL and our allies, you are the hero. You are the hero that's needed. And we've got to work together. We've got to work together. I remember this cute story that I heard not too long ago about the power of working together. There was this farmer, and he came across this well, and he saw that there was this cow that was in the well. And the cow was going to die if he didn't get out of this well. So the farmer and the cow had the same goal. They had the exact same goal. So the farmer, he got the shovel and he threw some dirt into the well, and the cow shook the dirt off and he stepped on the dirt. And the farmer kept throwing the dirt in, and the cow shook the dirt off and he stepped on the dirt. And the farmer and the cow, they kept doing this until that dirt kept building and building and building, until the dirt built high enough where the cow was able to then walk out of the well. See, they came together. They worked together. They had the same common goal. They knew that they wanted the cow out of the well. They had the same goal, but they didn't have the same position. They didn't have the same position. See, the cow's mere survival was dependent upon them reaching their goal. He had no other options. But the farmer, though he shared the same goal as the cow, his position was very different. He had options. His survival was not contingent upon that cow coming out of that well. And that's why IWL is so very important. Why it's so needed. Because the mission of IWL, accelerating women, the mission of equal pay for women, the mission right now of justice for all, it is critical. We have got to come together. We are fighting for survival for many. And when some people say, it's too much, it's too soon, that's because they have options. Their survival is not dependent on what happens right now. That's why it's critical that we work together, come together, be together. That's why it's so important that Be the Change is not just a theme. It's not just a theme. Over these next couple of days, you guys are going to hear some absolutely amazing speakers. But I need you to commit to this. I need you to commit to the fact that you won't just be entertained and you won't just sit around and get some great information. I need you to commit to the fact that you will take these 2 days to put together your plan of action, because we need you. We need you. IWL, we need you. You are the hero that we need right now. And I know the reality is that for some of us, this is a moment. And I know for others, this is a movement. And for some of us, it's just marketing. But for IWL and our allies, we've got to come together to create magic. We've got to come together to create magic. See, I saw a post not too long ago, and the post said that I thought 2020 was going to be the year that I get everything that I wanted. But actually, 2020 was the year that I learned to appreciate everything that I have. And that's the power of this year. That's the power of how you power forward in times of uncertainty. The first thing you do is you got to answer that question. What does this make possible? And when you focus in on the answer, the how is wrapped up in peace, clarity, and courage. We got to have the peace so that we can get the vision, so that we can decide. And when we decide, that's when we get the clarity to have the confidence to commit. And when we commit, we get the courage so that we can take action to get the results. I got this amazing, amazing magnet in the beginning of the year from IWL. And it has literally sat on my refrigerator freezer. And I literally see this every day. And I'm gonna read what it says. Change will not come if we wait for some other person or if we wait for some other time. We are the ones we've been waiting for. We are the change that we seek. IWL and our allies, you are the hero that we need. You are the change that we need. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.